Now we are happy to have Sumit start his first lecture on dynamics.
Okay. Hear me?
Okay. So I'd like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to present these lectures here. So what I'll try to do is in some cases I'll actually be able to explain things in detail and work out things. In some cases I won't be able to, but I'll try to give you an overall idea about the physics in most cases. So the aim, the main aim of this entire area is to explore the universal aspects of dynamics, namely universal aspects of many body systems or quantum field theories which are out of equilibrium, to use various techniques including the holographic principle. Mostly AdS CFT. So in equilibrium, an important ingredient in our understanding of physics is the notion of the renormalization group. What the renormalization group does, it gives you a framework to understand why physics at low energies is decoupled from physics at high energies. It helps to identify which features of the physics are insensitive to the microscopic details of the system. So this is very important both from a conceptual as well as from a practical point of view, because what it does is that it allows you to write down theoretical models which capture those important universal features, and then these theoretical models have a direct application to complex systems in nature which do not look like, you know, what the model you wrote down, but the model is good enough to explain those features. So let me draw this point. So it is RG, universal features. And this is in equilibrium. In a sense, this is very well understood. I wouldn't say always, you can always work it out, but the conceptually the thing is fairly well understood. In particular, even for strongly coupled systems, one can at least formulate the problem, for example, by putting the theory on a lattice and writing down a computer program. Theories on a lattice typically use Euclidean frameworks, and that's very well suited for equilibrium phenomena. When you go out of equilibrium, these notions of decoupling RG, they become problematic. It's because when you go out of equilibrium, time dependence of the system necessarily couples high energy behavior with low energy behavior. It's not that you cannot do it, but it just, I mean, the clean separation of what are relevant variables and what are irrelevant variables and the emergence of universality becomes a little bit problematic. And one of the things that brings up, one of the problems that comes when this thing happens is that you cannot just a priori write down a model and imagine that the model actually corresponds to something in reality. So this is of course a big drawback if you are not able to do that. In addition to this, particularly for strongly coupled systems, the number of theoretical tools which you can use to analyze a non-equilibrium behavior is rather limited. On the other hand, in recent years, particularly prompted by almost astounding experiments in cold atom systems, experimentalists can actually look in a fair amount of detail the details of non-equilibrium phenomena. So there is a lot of motivation to try to understand whatever you can about non-equilibrium physics. So that's the main aim, and that's where the holographic principle comes about. As you know, the holographic principle, or the AdS in its version, which is AdS-CFT, it relates, it establishes a duality between some particular quantum field theories with a theory of gravity. It's usually a string theory, but it's only useful most of the time when it is, when you can have a truncation to gravity. Now, most realistic systems in nature would not have this kind of property. And there are very, very special systems which you actually come from some constructions in string theory, typically things which have a lot of supersymmetry, where this connection is very well understood. So you wouldn't expect that for many systems in nature, or even models which try to model the system, like a Hubbard model, you can write a gravity dual for it, though people have made some attempts to do that. That's not the aim. The aim is to identify what are the low energy properties which are robust and which are universal. Because if you can identify some properties which are universal, then you can look for examples of this duality where you can expect these universal features to be manifest and use this to get some insight into the problem. So before doing that, let me lay down what is the typical physics problem you want to look at. I'll come to that. I mean, it's of course, that's the tricky part of it, of course. If you find from some rough, argument that something is universal, then there is a hope that you'll be able to capture in this. Okay. So here is a typical scenario which we would like to explore. So you start a system in equilibrium. And by equilibrium means if it's a zero temperature system, I'll take, for example, the ground state. If T is not equal to zero, it's some thermal state. And then you take this out of equilibrium. There are several ways of doing this, and one way to do that is to turn on a time dependent source. I mean, for example, you take a magnet, the magnet is in the ferromagnetic phase, all the spins are aligned, then everything is fine, and then you suddenly turn on an external magnetic field and make it time dependent. And you want to study the response of the system to such an object. So what a time-dependent source, the kind of time-dependent source which we will be mostly interested in these lectures, I'll call the time-dependent source a coupling, regardless of whether it's a mass or whether it's, you know, some other coupling. It's some parameter in the Hamiltonian which depends on time. And I'll take this parameter as a function of time, typically of the form that at asymptotic early and late times, this parameter goes to some constant. Pure state, if it is a Hamiltonian system, I'm assuming the Hamiltonian system has a ground state, which of course is a pure state. Okay? So, the Hamiltonian of the system is some initial Hamiltonian which can be very strongly coupled, and then some integral over space, d-dimensional space-time, and this is the the kind of thing which we will consider, and this is what I call the time dependent coupling. And so the time dependent coupling can be say something like this, or it could be something like that. And we want to prepare the system, for example, if it is like a zero temperature system, I want to prepare the system in the ground state, and you want to ask what kind of state appears at very late times and what kind of thing happens to the system. What the time dependent coupling of course does is to excite the system. It sort of populates some of the high energy, you know, the excited modes of the system, and then the because of the interactions in the system, the excited modes does something to it, and that's what we want to figure out. I mean, I haven't written anything yet. Eventually, what we will do is a situation where this is actually a conformal field theory, and this will be actually the real conformal dimension. But at this is just mnemonics to write down the general Hamilton. This need not be a conformal field theory. This can be some Hamiltonian, time independent Hamiltonian. So what would you expect? So this is like a lighting a fire in the middle of this room, and of course eventually what you expect is that the room eventually heats up and it sort of acquires a temperature which is by and large common everywhere, and we call this thermalization. So normally you might expect that most systems in nature would thermalize, so at late times you will get some kind of thermal behavior. Now, put this in quotation marks, because normally what we called a thermal state is of course is not a pure state, it is some mixed state with the Boltzmann density matrix, which has a Boltzmann distribution. And if this is a closed quantum system starting off with some pure state, even you are never going to get into a mixed state. That is a fundamental property. Unitarity of quantum mechanics. So what we might expect, however, that at late times the system approaches some kind of steady state. So we want to, so let's erase this. We should get some kind of steady state. And you might want to ask the questions, how generic is this behavior? And you want to ask, how does the system approach this? And finally, in what sense? Is this state an approximation to thermal state? These are of course century old problems in physics, which appears in very areas of physics, and these are issues which are associated with the world thermalization. And in these lectures I will not delve too much into this, but I will certainly try to enumerate some of the basic problems in this. In view of what I just said, you want to figure out what is universal in this process. You want to identify what kind of things are universal in this relaxation to some steady state, what kind of things are universal and what kind of things you hope to compute, you know, from some model. In equilibrium, universal behavior is ubiquitous for critical phenomena. Yeah. Yes, I will always think or go to some constant. I mean, if the coupling, of course, is always time dependent, nothing is going to happen. You hope that it will always be dynamic. I mean, it's not even guaranteed that in this situation it will acquire a steady state, but I'll always restrict. Absolutely. And then you can get non-equilibrium steady states, right? Yeah. And I'll not discuss those. We all understand universal behavior near critical points. The insight into this is one of the great progresses in theoretical physics in the last century. And so one of the understandings was that when you come close, there are a large variety of systems, and when you come close to the critical point, the behavior of certain quantities are universal in the sense that they are the same for a wide variety of microscopic systems. The things which, as we know, are universal are critical exponents, and so those are quantities which you hope to be able to compute theoretically from some models and make contact with experiments. Out of equilibrium, and this is the thing which the renormalization group explains. What the renormalization group treats you, tells you, or teaches you is that when you come close to a critical point, there are many parameters in the system. So typical microscopic systems have thousands and thousands of parameters. But however, it's only a few combinations of these parameters which are relevant to the critical behavior. For example, in the example of a magnet near a Curie point, it's some temperature and the magnetic field. These are only the two relevant parameters, but there are, of course, millions of them if you take a piece of iron or nickel or something like that. The fact that there are a few relevant parameters which control the critical behavior is that's precisely what's the cause, underlying cause behind universality, and that's what makes models useful in describing critical behavior. In non-equilibrium, this is not so clear. These notions are not so clear. Yet, we will find, in fact, there are pretty good arguments, not very well understood. There's some universality persists, and I'll describe them in some detail. In various situations. And this will be one of the emphasis in our talks. What are the techniques you might wish, you might hope you will be able to use to understand a problem like this? So these are some regimes of the coupling which we can hope theoretically to make progress with. The first one is, of course, weak disturbances. Namely, the amplitude of variation is small. In this case, so if you take like some h equal to h zero, some operator t and x, then of course you can use time dependent perturbation theory. And this the lowest order is called linear response. And to give an example of a linear response, and this is something the students should be able to derive, is the following. So in time dependent perturbation theory, of course, you solve the same old Schrodinger equation of the system. This is the Schrodinger picture. And you want to compute the, for example, a correlation function. Generally, I'll say that you want to compute some expectation value of some quantity. I'll call this A. In terms of this perturbation of this lambda, and now I'll give you what the general result of that is. This is a standard result. So let lambda, I'll take lambda of t just for the purpose of this, is 0 for t less than or equal to 0 and some given function for t greater than 0. And I'll call this part of the Hamiltonian the perturbation. Where these are given in the interaction picture, namely, I use the time independent part of the Hamiltonian to define operators which evolve like that. So h1t is also, which is y. And this quantity has a name. It's actually, let me come back to that. So in the case when this h1 has this particular form, so when h1 with some operator x and t, and the case where where I'm computing the expectation value of the same operator which is used to perturb the system, then there is a nice well, just repeating what's in there. Yeah. I'll write slightly larger. Okay. This you can read, right? Yeah, actually yesterday also had some problem. This is good enough? Plus higher order terms, and this is multiplied by lambda of t, is this, so that, is this readable? Yep. Now, this thing has a name, so usually, so this is something which is called a retarded Green's function. Which is the commutator of these. The important thing about having the ability to do perturbation theory is that what you need to compute here are actually equilibrium quantities, because this is the quantity which is computable in the original Hamiltonian H naught. So there is no obstruction to compute this thing. And if the amplitude remains small, you can keep imagine keeping doing order by order expansion and obtain answers like this. So this is the theory of retarded Green's function, and there are well developed tools which allow you to compute these things. The next regime, which was the subject of Mukund's lecture is like the hydrodynamic regime. I'll use this in a loose sense. This is the regime where the amplitudes can be order 1, they can be large or small, but the variation, in particular the time variation of the coupling, in this case I'm only consider couplings which are just for simplicity, which are homogeneous in space but functions of time, the variations of the couplings is small. Of course, to say something is small, there has to be a scale in the theory. So this is only applicable when you have a scale which, and you can consider the amplitude to be small compared to the scale. For example, you can take a theory at some given temperature, and if the variations are small compared to the scale of the temperature, this is a good expansion. If you take a zero temperature system, but the system has an energy gap, the energy gap provides a scale, and so if the variations are small compared to the energy gap, this is a possible way of doing this still. I wouldn't call it hydrodynamics, but it's still some kind of derivative expansion. So this is what Mukund has explained. There is a third regime when nothing is small, and that of course difficult. But we'll try to make most progress in this third regime, where you might think in many cases, and I'll just come in momentarily, where something is small, but it will turn out that that smallness actually breaks down in a very interesting way. One of the problems which we will discuss in some detail, in particular the AdS CFT applications in understanding that problem, is a problem which appears when lambda of t involves a critical point. And let me try to explain what do I mean. When I say it's a critical point, what I really mean is an equilibrium critical point. Okay? So what I mean by this is that, for example, I have a coupling which starts some non-zero value. So this is a case where the Hamiltonian is some critical Hamiltonian. Most cases it will be a conformal field theory Hamiltonian. Times again, this is going to be a relevant operator. So the presence of the relevant operator provides a scale, it breaks conformal invariance and drives the system out of conformal. So the theory, the original theory, okay. So, and you take, I shouldn't say critical, okay. And then you take lambda, start from some constant value lambda and smoothly go down to zero. So this being a constant at all times, since theory is out of criticality, the theory has a mass gap. And you, at some speed, you approach the theory which is critical. Critical means if there was no time dependence, then the theory would be critical. Yeah. This is even another case where you can start off like that. Say some lambda naught, it going to some lambda naught, and it crosses at some point the value lambda equal to 0 where the theory is critical. It can't be better than this, I think.
Yeah, it can be better.
These are, I think, for whiteboards, no?
No.
Okay. Okay, so let's, you can either deal with this or deal with that. let me give you an example of how to deal with this, you know, a real physical example. And people actually do this in experiments. So, take for example a magnet, and with a zero magnetic field to begin with, and tune the temperature exactly at the Curie temperature. This is a critical theory. Fluctuations are very large, and we sort of understand the nature of this critical theory when it is in equilibrium. Then you turn on a magnetic field, say some positive value of the magnetic field, say some large value of that magnetic field. So, turn this on. So far it is a constant. So, what will it do? I mean, it will sort of align the spins all in the direction of the magnetic field. So, think of this as the magnetic field and the theory is exactly at T equal to Tc. So, once you have a magnetic field, the theory is no longer critical because you have a magnetic field. I mean, everything is sort of aligned in some way. So, the spins are aligned this way. And imagine doing this change in a way which is very slow compared to the scale which is set by the magnetic field. So, what the magnetic field does is to produce a gap in fluctuations in the equilibrium system. So, what you want to do is to take this variation, the variation is characterized by some time scale delta t. You want to take delta t to be much, much larger compared to the inverse gap of the system. This is the classic situation, and if the magnetic field was a constant, this is a classic situation when you might think that adiabatic perturbation theory would be a good approximation. This is what you do in textbook quantum mechanics. And indeed, at early times, you can use adiabatic perturbation theory, and let me remind you what adiabatic perturbation theory is. So, again you are always solving this equation okay. So, when the Hamiltonian is time dependent, of course, it's there is no point in trying to take this at some time and diagonalize it, does not immediately give you some solution of the Schrodinger equation. But what you can do is to write this psi of t as a basis of what I call instantaneous eigenstates. Instantaneous eigenstates are defined by this equation. What this equation means is that in this equation, treat t as just some parameter. For every value of this parameter, diagonalize the Hamiltonian and obtain this eigenvectors and eigenvalues, and that is what I will call the instantaneous eigenvalue. Okay? Once you do that, and this is always you can do such a thing. The point is that because the Hamiltonian keeps changing, the instantaneous eigenvalues keep changing. So, this coefficient now obeys a complicated equation, but nevertheless it is some equation, and it turns out it is some equation which you can solve the equation for this object A n of t in a derivative expansion. And this derivative expansion is good when the precise condition for the derivative expansion, I will just write down, is the following. Can you read this? Should I write somewhere else? These are all instantaneous eigenstates, are small compared EKT. Is the notation clear? So, what I am doing this, I am taking the time derivative of this Hamiltonian and computing the matrix elements of the time derivative. The matrix elements, the vectors are these instantaneous eigenstates, and the right hand side is the difference of energies. But what do you mean by energies? The instantaneous energies. So long as this condition is good, there are well developed techniques of how to obtain the solution of the Schrodinger equation in a systematic expansion. So that is the kind of thing you might imagine to be able to do when you turn on a magnetic field, and as the picture shows, that this thing is going very slowly with as a function of time. If this expansion was really valid, let us try to look at what would be the response of the system. In this particular example, we are thinking of the response means the magnetization of the system. How would that behave? So, let me draw a picture of how it. You do not have colored chalks, huh? Yeah. Oh, we have. Okay. Stay with this picture. So, the response of the system, I hope I do this right. If I do not do this right, you have to correct me. If I will call this the adiabatic response. If this is given by mean field theory, you know that magnetization goes as 1/3 power of the magnetic field, and that is what I have tried to draw here. But is this what really happens in the system? Of course not. Because as you come close to this region where the magnetic field is very small, the instant what is appearing here are the spacings of the instantaneous energy levels. In particular, if you were to start from the ground state of the system, the thing that will be most important is the instantaneous energy gap. But by definition, it is that instantaneous energy gap which vanishes at this point. So, therefore, this condition will be necessarily violated as you approach this point, and the response of the magnetic field cannot be something like that. If you really try to calculate what the response is, what you will find is it will shoot off after some point, which is given by this, then it drops down and sort of oscillates up and down towards this thing. So, that is actually true. It can oscillate around something else, you are right. So, let me draw the oscillations around something else. If there is, particularly if there is dissipation, I mean it will be. Yeah, so this time will be much later actually, yes, yeah, don't cross the picture that much, okay, yeah. And this is where you can see that it is departing from the adiabatic response, it sort of overshoots and then it drops down, okay. So, let us try to estimate in a very rough fashion. Yeah, that is right. I mean, for a thermal state, you should not have these matrix elements, they will be you put in a density matrix, but still it can be done. Imagine this doing for, I gave you an example of a thermal system because that is most familiar. You can take a quantum critical system and it is exactly the same kind of thing appears. Okay. So, let us try to estimate what is happening here. Yeah. So what this expansion does is to obtain a solution for a n of t around its zeroth level, which is just e to the minus I e n of t t. Okay, and then the next terms all have ratios of things like this. So the corrections to the leading adiabatic answer are small, provided this condition is satisfied. So that bit sort of guaranteed that they are close enough. Historically, this kind of question was asked by Tom Kibble in the 1970s in a rather very different context. So what Kibble was interested in was the following problem. The problem was a problem in cosmology. So you have an expanding universe. As the universe expands, it cools. And as the universe cools, typical theories of particle physics predict that there could be various kinds of phase transitions, first order transitions, second order transitions, and so on. And Kibble was interested in the class of theories which actually lead to second order transitions as a function of the temperature. And the kind of transitions he was interested in were transitions where it is a kind of an order disorder transition. So as the temperature goes down, the system tries to place order. Now, as the universe is expanding, and if you go from a disorder to an ordered phase, so that means, you know, some order parameter is lining up, it necessarily cannot line up everywhere in the world. So generally, there will be patches of the universe where the order parameter is aligned in different ways. The kind of the boundaries between these patches would be what we'll call defects, topological defects in theory. They could be like, depending on the type of symmetry breaking transition you are considering, they could be monopoles, or they could be vortices, strings, you know, what have you. And Kibble was interested in asking, can I say something completely robust about the density of these things without knowing the excruciating details of the underlying theory? So that was the point. Of course, this is a very difficult problem to crack. Kibble had great insight, and that insight was applied to systems in condensed matter physics by Zurek, and in recent years it has been applied to quantum critical phenomena by a large number of authors. And as I mentioned in the very beginning, there are, you know, variety of cold atom experiments which actually try to look for this kind of. So the argument was Kibble, Kibble-Zurek argument goes typically like this. So I will phrase the argument for zero temperature quantum systems. By zero temperature quantum systems, what I mean really, of course, you start with the system at zero temperature in the ground state of a quantum Hamiltonian. And the system is a closed system, so it's not connected with the bath. And this is the phase, so forget about magnetic field here, think of some coupling which you tune. So for lambda not equal to 0, the system has a gap. And as lambda approaches some critical value lambda c, which is this picture, I take lambda c to be equal to 0, the energy gap of the system, as is behaves as some power law in its departure from the critical value. This is the standard, you know, thing of critical phenomena. The easiest cases are the ones where the approach to the critical point is in some power law fashion. These things have names. This is called a dynamical critical exponent. And that is called the correlation length exponent. So the correlation length goes as minus nu. So z just gives you the relative scaling between time and space in this system. For relativistic system, z is equal to 1. For usual non-relativistic system, z equal to 2. So this is the situation when you have just an equilibrium system at some non-zero value of lambda, very close to lambda equal to lambda c. So let us now try and figure out what happens when you approach lambda c in this dynamical situation. So as I said, that if the initial rate of change is very small, so I will say it initially slow, you must have, for example, give you an example. Suppose in this particular case, lambda of t is some a plus b, some constant, it goes to some constant at t equal to minus infinity, some another constant at t equal to plus infinity. So this is the rate of change, this is the scale which gives you the rate of change of that coupling. So you would imagine from what I just told you that adiabatic holds when the time derivative of the gap. So what I tell you, what do you mean by time derivative of the gap? So I'll call this e of t. So what I mean by this equation is that this is the equilibrium value. So what I write down is an instantaneous gap is just given by e gap at lambda equal to lambda of t. Just you take, suppose you know what the equilibrium behavior of the system is, you know how the gap is a function of lambda, and by hand replace that lambda by lambda of t. That is what we call the instantaneous gap of the system. This is sometimes called a Landau criterion. Absolutely, that is right. I mean, the point is that the first excited state is the first one that will be populated. So once that fails, everything else will fail. That is the point. Okay. So now let us assume so let us write this equation. So assume self-consistently which we will come back to later that adiabaticity by breaking of adiabaticity means that this is of the same order of that, okay, happens near t equal to 0. Actually, let me change this thing. If we just go from positive to negative, take a equal to 0 just for the heck of it. So this just goes from minus lambda naught to plus lambda naught as time evolves. This criterion. So this criterion tells you that the time variation of the instantaneous gap is small compared to the square of the gap. And it, why is that? Tutorial exercise maybe. This is in standard quantum mechanics textbooks actually. This is the condition for validity of adiabatic perturbation theory. Okay. So then I can approximate e gap of t in this region by say like lambda naught vt z nu. All I have done, I have sort of copied this formula in this formula lambda equal to 0 is the critical point, so lambda c is 0. So, I just substituted this by assuming v times t is very small. So, that is what the answer, and then you rewrite what this condition is. So, that condition, which will be another exercise for the tutorials, is going to tell you that the breakdown happens at t equal to, this is called the Keble-Zurek time, it's given by this is all order of magnitude. This is a very simple exercise to plug this thing in into this equation, set it to be equal to 1, and then derive that. The energy gap at the Keble-Zurek time is given by plus z nu. So, what is happening? In this picture, this is, I will call the Keble-Zurek time, I will call it minus t Keble-Zurek. This is where you cannot, the time evolution of the system starts becoming interesting. See, adiabatic time evolution is boring because it just keeps the system in the instantaneous ground state, it just follows it all the way down. Okay. If the system was gapped all the time and I have not come, I have not assumed anything about v yet, we will see that v needs to be small for this self consistency to hold. If the speed is small, as we will see very soon, there is at some point this adiabaticity is going to break down. So, what do you do after that? The self consistency of this, namely the fact that I have assumed that this happens near t equal to 0, where for example, I can replace the tan hyperbolic by v of t, and this is just an example, requires that. So, self consistency requires that v times Keble-Zurek must be less than 1, and if you compute that from what I just showed, this translates into v much, much smaller this is, that means, I have an evolution which is initially slow compared to what? There is only one scale in the system which is set by the value of this relevant operator lambda naught, and this is the mass scale, this raised to this power provides you the mass scale by which you were to compare v with. Because that instantaneous mass scale is vanishing, the system is thrown out of equilibrium. So, what do you do after that? Now, this is the regime, there is no, nothing is small, we said in amplitude is not small, amplitude can be as large as you wish. The time variation, you started to make it small, but does not work because you have approached a critical point. So, everything is thrown, all the approximation methods are thrown out of the window. So, what do? But if you are smart enough, you make assumptions which look pretty dicey, and this is the kind of thing we will try to make it a little, understanding this a little better. So, what Keble and Zurek they assumed is that for t, the time evolution is diabatic. Now, what I mean by diabatic is the opposite of adiabatic, that is why the A is out. What diabatic means is in, it is called a sudden approximation. It's a different name for sudden approximation. So, what this means is the following. Suppose I had a Hamiltonian, which as a function of time looked like this. At some time t 0, the Hamiltonian changed from some initial Hamiltonian to some final Hamiltonian. Okay? And it happened very suddenly. Okay? In such a situation, there are again standard approximations methods in quantum mechanics which become applicable. So, what do you do? You start out with the ground state, say for example, or any state for that matter. For a time independent Hamiltonian, I assume you know how to calculate the time evolution. So, it is going to become some state psi naught at this time t equal to t 0, and suddenly the Hamiltonian changes, but that is not a problem. Now, we are going to solve the Schrodinger equation with a new Hamiltonian, but with an initial state which is psi naught. That is what the sudden approximation is. And that again, since it is a time independent Hamiltonian, I will assume that you will know how to do this. So, what that means is that once this happens, the system at this time is frozen to whatever state it has evolved into starting from the initial ground state. In this situation, what this means is that at this point onwards, till again, and they assume that it is sort of symmetric to plus t of k z, the system is completely frozen. So, anything you calculate here is whatever will be the result out here. The state is exactly the same, right. So, if you are able to calculate things here, which you could approximately do by assuming that adiabatic time evolution is valid up to here, then you can calculate what happens to various physical quantities when the thing actually emerges out from this dynamical protocol. This of course, is a very drastic assumption. Yeah. Yeah, but in order to calculate the thing here, you have to time evolve from here to there. That is what I mean by the calculation. In reality, we have no reason to believe why this is true. Okay, but this is just an assumption. So, let us see what happens when you make this assumption. I mean, yeah. You are supposed to really evolve. You do not know how to do it because everything has broken down. So, what this guy said, let us make an assumption that it does not, it is just frozen. Yeah, then you have to do an evolution again. But you should also actually do an evolution between minus t k z and plus t k z. Tomorrow's lecture, we will see how to do that. Okay. That is where the holographic methods come in. Okay. But in usual quantum field theory, there are very few techniques which allow you to do this actually. So, this is the assumption number one. And then they made a second assumption, assumption number two, which mimics what we know about equilibrium critical phenomena. So, they said that in equilibrium critical phenomena, we know that the only terms in the Hamiltonian which have any significance at all are the terms which are associated with the relevant operators. Right? So, let us assume this is a normal critical point which has only one relevant operator just for simplicity. So, they said let me assume that in this region, I will call this the critical region. There is only one length scale which is relevant. Why? I do not know. I mean, if it were critical, Ken Wilson told you why. If it is equilibrium, Ken Wilson told you why. But if it is not in equilibrium, we do not know. That is part of the problem to figure out why this is true. But if this is true, so this is like having a scaling hypothesis in a dynamical situation. But once you have that, you say if this is the only scale, everything should be determined by dimensional analysis. So that critical scale I take to be the instantaneous correlation length. So with these two assumptions, it is not very hard to show from these equations. I'm running, let me erase this. So suppose I want to calculate the expectation value of some operator with conformal dimension lambda. In the critical region. So by these two assumptions, this should be the correlation length at the Kibble-Zurek time raised to the power delta times nu, where delta is a conformal dimension. Delta times minus, yeah, sorry, minus delta nu, because this is the correlation length, you have to put in a minus sign. Okay. And then I have given you all the formula, which will be again part of the tutorials. So once you use all this formula, what you get is a nice answer for this object, which I will just write down. So this just follows from what I have written here. So that goes as the fact that I have used the assumption number 1 is manifest in evaluating that correlation length at the Kribble-Zurek time. Otherwise, it would change, right, as a function of time. We don't know how it changes or whether it even makes sense to talk about an instantaneous correlation length in that region. And the fact that this is proportional to an appropriate power of a length scale is the assumption number 2. So given that, you get this thing, this is called Kibble-Zurek scaling. And in spite of the nature of these assumptions, which appear to be not very well founded, it turns out this is actually fairly good. There's a sort of controversy. I cannot read experimental teacher papers very well, but people have seen sort of hints of such scaling behavior even in real experiments, and they have certainly seen the numerical simulations. I'll give you the answer for 2-point function, but that requires a certain hypothesis. Yeah, so this tells you this is again with a Hamiltonian with some, which is some conformal field theory plus. That's right, then it has to be this way. Okay. There, of course, can be things which are 0. Okay. Okay, so one of our aims will be to try to get some handle of what is really going on. Now, it's a bit funny to say that this object is really frozen in this region. So what people have done is to advance a slightly modified version of this kind of thing, which is claiming that there is a scaling function, namely that in this region, it is not really true that this is actually really frozen. This is a slight improvement of that. This goes as that object times some slowly varying function of not the time and the Keble-Zurek time separately, but the ratios of that. So that's the scaling hypothesis, that there is a single scaling function which is some smooth function of this object T upon TKZ. So tomorrow we will show how this thing actually naturally comes out of in holographic setups. There are similar scaling hypothesis which are for two-point functions, which Gautam was talking about. So let me talk about, in fact, equal time two-point functions. So that again we'll have, you know, some this power just dimensional analysis, term sum function this is very much in the spirit of equilibrium critical phenomena, where there is no time, but one obtains, you know, similar scaling functions for correlation functions, where the separation is, sorry, it's not, this is the correlation length of Keble-Zurek. Correlation length is that correlation, this object is called the correlation length, where you wouldn't have this, but you will have something like that in equilibrium. And as I said, these are things which are very difficult to understand because the theoretical framework is not very well known. And one of the aims, I mean, at least for me, one of the motivations of studying this thing in the AdS CFT context is to see whether I can get any, even an approximate handle of things like this. This kind of protocols have a name, it's called quantum quench. And the word quench typically refers to a very quick change of things, that in the dictionary that's what it means. But somehow the community has also decided to call this kind of thing a slow quench. It's a kind of contradiction in terms, but I'll stick to that terminology. That's right. Yeah, it does assume that it's not going to be an eigenstate of the new Hamiltonian. Right. Okay, so this one thing we would like to understand. Let's now go over to the 5 minutes. Five. So I won't do any AdS CFT today. I'll do AdS CFT tomorrow. Okay. But this is good. This is real physics. Okay. So let me go to the other regime, which I'll call a fast quench. So forget about all this. By the way, a nice description of the scaling hypothesis for Keble-Zurek actually appears in a relatively recent paper by which gives you in very nice details the various protocols and the various things associated with this. instantaneous quench. In fact, I'll take a Hamiltonian which looks like this. Some operator delta t. So basically, t less than 0, the Hamiltonian is h 0, and t greater than 0, the Hamiltonian is h 0 plus lambda times the operator. So this is the regime of validity of a sudden approximation. This also is very complicated, particularly for a generic interacting system. You cannot just sit down and start doing this. In this case, Calabrese and Cardi had a very nice insight into, you know, how to deal with this problem. So, as I said, this Hamiltonian sort of looks like this. Take a minus sign. Doesn't matter. This is h 0 plus minus lambda times O. And the time evolution of the Hamiltonian brings us to some state at the time when this quench is really happening. Okay? Now, that state is usually pretty complicated. It's not very easy to figure out that state. And in fact, if you get the time during the discussion or the tutorials, we will try to derive that state in free field theory, and you'll find how complicated that is. Okay? But the techniques are known how to do that. So, what Cardi and Calabrese said is that that state psi naught has a very nice approximation, which I'll first write down, where for reasons which will become, if Justin gives me another 5 minutes, a reason which will become quite clear, I'll call this what is called a boundary state. When h 0 is a CFT, h 0 is a gapped system, and h 0 minus is a CFT. And tau naught is a scale which is the inverse, roughly the inverse of the energy gap. Okay. Now, the physical reason of why such a thing, and this is a state which I call a boundary state, is one of the special class of states which are conformally invariant, which satisfies conformally invariant boundary conditions. String theory people would recognize the kind of states which we are talking about. And the physical intuition which goes behind this is the following. So, you have started with a system which has some gap, which is E gap, okay? And then it had evolved into something, and that state psi naught is just the, if I start out with the ground state, this is just e to the minus I h naught t acting on psi naught. It's just some constant time evolution on that ground state. It's still the ground state. But the moment you change the Hamiltonian, that state becomes an excited state of the new Hamiltonian. That's what the physics is, right? Now, you can try to ask what kind of excitations does this excited state have? And it sort of sounds quite intuitive that if the gap is large enough, then you're not going to excite states which are too much above the gap. So, you need, normally speaking, if the gap was really very, very large, you would expect that this would sort of relax down to a conformally invariant state of the conformal field theory. But if the gap is finite, what you would expect is that, okay, it's a little bit different from a conformal invariant state, but the amount of difference would not be in states which are too far away removed from the gap. This is like an exponential factor which suppresses, you know, those things, you know, those excitations. It turns out that, and I'll now go, I will not go through the detail of this. If you were to measure now the the expectation value of some operator you can now write that as this is H1, this is the new Hamiltonian, this is the conformal field. I'm sorry for changing the notation so frequently. Just by this assumption, so this is, and this is some correlation function in a conformal field theory. Okay, so you might hope to be able to compute this if you are, if your, you know, knowledge of the conformal field theory is good. And typically, when in 1+1 dimensions, conformal invariance is very powerful, and there are well-known techniques which you can use to compute these objects. And this object can be represented, in fact, in a path integral over a strip, where you imagine putting conformally invariant boundary conditions in. You can see that the size of that strip in the Euclidean time direction is just 2 times tau naught. Yeah, you have to divide it by that thing actually. You can normalize that on this. Okay, so at the last minute, so once you know some techniques, so what you can use powerful techniques of conformal field theories in 1+1 dimensions is beautiful. It's complex analysis. Where you can use to map this problem is something which you can write down the answer to, and I'll give you one answer and stop. And the answer is that of an expectation value of an operator as a function of time for t greater than 0. And I take this operator, an operator which is not conserved, because something is conserved, it is a constant in time. Okay, in that state. And the answer is, and it's not very hard to write down what the answer is given by where delta is the conformal dimension. So what does this thing? So this is an operator which is not conserved, and you would expect that in the long time limit, when it sort of everything has relaxed down, the operator will go to 0. This tells you how does it go to 0. This is the question of the approach to the equilibrium. This gives you a relaxation time, which is 2 tau naught by pi times delta. And one thing that this tells you, there's nothing universal about the relaxation time. Why? Because what tau naught is, it depends on the microscopics of the system. It's roughly 1 upon the energy gap, but whether this norm is 1 or 5,000, it depends on, you know, what the microscopic says. But the great thing about this formula, if I take the relaxation time for an operator of conformal dimension delta 1 and take the ratio of the relaxation time for the operator 2, this is exactly equal to delta 2 by delta 1, and that's universal. This is a result in 2 dimensions. whether something like this is valid in higher number of dimensions. This formalism is valid to write down. It's, and there's a good reason to expect that this state can be written down in terms of such boundary state. But whether in higher dimensions, whether such a thing can be done, I do not know. But this is certainly interesting that you have identified something universal about the relaxation process to equilibrium. I think I should stop here, and the rest of the lectures will try to flesh out some of these things and use of, I didn't mention the word AdS CFT so far, but maybe I'll do that tomorrow. Okay. When you're doing the quench. So there is a tutorial this evening, right? Tomorrow? So at some point, I will, or one of the students will, do an explicit calculation of psi naught for free field theory. And we will see to what extent this kind of thing is actually valid. And the final, I mean, answer is that you expect this to be valid for long distance quantities. You don't expect this to be valid for short. But then you don't expect any universal behavior for short distance quantities anyway. So you're saying that doing something, actually I'll comment on that in the third lecture. So you might imagine doing the following. Take a model which is solvable. Don't make any of these assumptions and just try to do it and see how good is this assumption. And we have sort of done that, and you'll see it has some interesting twists and turns to it actually. This whole trying to approximate this by a certain thing. No, this is actually in the other regime, because this is the extreme regime where the quench is very fast compared to the initial gap in the system. Kibble-Zurek, the quench was slow compared to the initial gap. And we will talk a lot about, you know, something which is fast but not so sudden, and how this relates to this kind of situation. But and the physics is a little bit different actually. No, you froze it when the quench actually became fast. I mean, there is nothing like slow or fast when the correlation length is a function of time. So at some time the quench became fast, and then I froze it. Okay, but initially, the fact that initially it was slow was important. That allowed you an adiabatic evolution for some time. That thing is not available here.